away with some information that will help you make an informed decision. So before we get into all of our sections, I just want to introduce the panel. My name is Karen Stone. I'm a broker here at Town, here in this office. I do live in the neighborhood as well, and I specialize in both rentals and sales. So on any given day, I'm working with buyers, sellers, landlords, renters, developers, etc. And I've been in business now for just about 10 years. I've lived in New York for 12 from Los Angeles. Debbie?
Hi, I'm Debbie Blumenfield. I am a partner at Graubard and Blumenfield, and I'm a residential real estate attorney. And I've been practicing for a little over 13 years. And helping buyers and sellers buy and sell property in and around New York City. Nice to meet you all.
Hi, I'm Doug Ruttenberg. I'm a tax partner at PKF O'Connor Davies. We have offices in Westchester. We have an office 53rd and 5th, and a few other locations. And I specialize in representing individuals in their tax and accounting needs that they have, and many of those clients have real estate. And they might have real estate that's their residential rental, their home that they own, maybe they're renting out their principal home, maybe they have residency issues when they start to rent out a home that they own. So I try to talk to my clients about all of the tax issues that they face from a federal, state, and city tax perspective.
That sounds scary.
It's not. It's fun when I talk about it.
No, I know. My name is Donna Klemick, and my company is Declutter123, and I am a decluttering coach, and I stage homes for sale. And what usually happens is Karen says, got an apartment, it needs some work. I go in and I work directly for the homeowner to help them streamline, to make good, healthy decisions about what to keep and what not to keep. And if you're living in the apartment, which is really 90% of the time, I say, okay, you realize you have to live here, but now let's stage it. We'll use as much of your stuff as we can, but we want to streamline it and make it show well, and we work together to do that.
So this evening, we're each going to be talking for about 15 minutes about our assigned topics, obviously, and our roles in the process. We do want this to be more informal, so if you have questions, please raise your hand. We're happy to answer them. All of us have actually worked together with lots of different clients, so we have experience, we have war stories, we have success stories that we're happy to share, and if you have very specific questions about your needs, feel free to come up to us after and ask us as well. So I'm here today, obviously, as a broker, so I want to share some information with you about what a broker does and the role that a broker plays in the transaction. I do find, though, that I need to kind of preface it with what's going on in the market. I feel like most people want to know, you know, what's going on right now. A lot of you are reading reports, probably. We actually have our Q3 aggregate report here. And so I just wanted to go a little bit into what's going on in the market. Overall, if you ask me how's the market, I would respond with which one. Overall, we are seeing that the average price point here in Manhattan only, which is what we're talking about here, is going up. However, that number is slightly skewed because of a lot of the new development that has been going up. As you know, there are lots of holes in the ground, there are lots of cranes, there's lots of new development going up, and it's that kind of sector that's muting what's going on in the resale market. Okay, so from a resale standpoint, we actually have a tale of three different markets. We have the $1 million and under market, which is your studios and your one bedrooms and sometimes a two bedroom. We have your $1 million to $3 million market, which again is your two bedrooms, maybe up to three or four, and then your $3 million and up. And the $3 million and up, sad to say, is considered the luxury market here in Manhattan. So the $1 million and under market is performing very well. We have seen inventory go up over the years, with the peak being back in September of 2015. That was considered the peak. Prices were going sky high in all of these sectors, and now they're kind of leveling out, and we're in what's called a transition market. So the $1 million and under market, we are seeing properties selling very quickly. Personally, most of the apartments that I list, as long as they're listed properly and priced properly, they will sell quickly. I'm seeing bidding wars, and that's kind of the bread and butter right now. Your $1 million to $3 million market, that is much more product specific and price sensitive. What I'm seeing as I'm working with buyers is that they're looking, they're seeing that prices are coming down, they're kind of waiting, and nobody's really in a rush, okay? So in this sector, it's really important to be pricing it right if you want to move it quickly. And then obviously the $3 million and up market, which we just talked about, there's a lot of new inventory coming. That has definitely slowed down. Overall, we are seeing that there is more inventory month over month, year over year. There is more inventory, and you'll see some stats in that booklet that I gave you. And we are seeing that the days on market is also going up, which means that it is taking a little bit longer to trade. What I will point out about these reports and any reports that you're reading and comps that you're looking at, especially those that show sold comps, those were actually in contract about 6 months ago. It generally takes about 3 to 4 months from contract to close for a co-op to sell, and then about 4 to 6 weeks, right, for it to be filed, and then we see what it actually sold for. So we just finished Q3, so we're talking about transactions that went into contract, possibly still in Q1. So always take what you see in these reports with a grain of salt, okay? And there's so many micro neighborhoods and micro markets that we have here, so I just gave you a very broad general overview of the market, but if you want to talk about your specific market, I'd be happy to give you more details on that. Are there any questions about the market? No. Okay, so now I will jump right into what does a broker do? Many people want to know, do I need a broker? What is the broker going to do for me? And I've broken this up into 4 different categories. So a broker is there to give you the information that you need to make that informed decision. We have the information. As I just said, these statistics, they're from 6 months ago. We actually are on the street every day, day in and day out, transacting. We know what the open house attendance has been. We know why an apartment might not be selling. Maybe it's not selling because there's a tenant in place. There's so much information out there that you as the public can see. You have access to StreetEasy. Who's on StreetEasy? And on Zillow, right? A lot of buyers, a lot of sellers are smart. They have access to all this information, but what we do is we help make that information make sense. We're also there to negotiate for you. About 70 to 80% of buyers are working with brokers right now. So why not have your own representation, right? How about the connections that we have with other brokers within the industry? When I hear of something that Tammy's listing that I know about before the public knows about, and the relationships that I have with other brokers that I'd rather work with on the buying side than working with a direct buyer. And we generally streamline the process for you. There's so many steps along the way. There's so many players. There's so many advisors that you're listening to. And the broker is just one of them. The National Association of Realtors, there was a recent report that actually showed that a broker, by listing with a broker, you will actually get about 15% more in terms of purchase price than you will by attempting to do it on your own. And when I say that 80% of buyers are working with brokers, there are a lot of brokers to reach out to as well. So it is on the broker to have that outreach to the brokerage community. We talked about the pulse of the market and that we're regularly transacting. So it's that experience that the broker really has to offer to you. Now, let's talk a little bit about pricing. Everybody always wants to know, what's my home worth? And the reality, I hate to say it, the buyer doesn't care what you think it's worth. They don't care what I think it's worth. They don't care what the attorney thinks it's worth. It's the buyer that is dictating what they think. So now the question is, how do we price it? How do we come up with a strategy to get the buyers through the door? The price and the marketing and the condition of it are the three things that will sell the home. So we focus a lot on that price. And we just talked about the market and what's going on. Again, we're looking at comps that are both active as well as those that did not sell and expired, as well as those that did sell. We care about what did sell because we obviously know what the market is willing to pay, but what did sell 6 months ago is very different from what a buyer might be willing to pay today. So that is why those active comps are important. So we can either price it above market, we could price it right with the market. Once we've got marketing, now that we've priced it right, how do we get the people through the door? So many people think, oh, it's easy. I have my iPhone and I just maybe stick one of those like wide angle lenses on it and I'm gonna be able to capture it and photograph it beautifully, and that's gonna get people in. Well, a good broker will do a few more things than that, including taking the professional photos, taking floor plans, so you know we're not just going off of the really ratty facts that maybe your management company sent us, writing a professional description, showing the buyer that there's actually life in this home rather than a bedroom and a bathroom, right? How about where the buyers are looking? Most of them are not looking in the newspaper anymore, right? We know that. About 80% of them are looking online. So being online is where we need to be. So the outlets that we need to advertise in include StreetEasy. Many of us are still using StreetEasy. However, new rules went into effect a few months ago, and we're no longer seeing quite as many listings on StreetEasy. You should know that StreetEasy and Zillow and Trulia are all part of one family, so as long as it's advertising one, it does get advertised in the others. But that's not a policed site. What does that mean? Nobody's making sure whether or not those listings are accurate. So the brokers, as a buying broker and as a selling broker, we know what's going on in the building, we know what's contract, but the general public might not, okay? But we still need to get in front of those eyeballs. As an agent, I believe in spending money on marketing. Most companies will give money to a broker to spend on that marketing for you. And most of them, at least here at town, they give it to us per listing. So we don't have to dig deep into our pockets. If you wanted a list in December and oops, I've already spent all my marketing money, I can't afford to pay now to market your property. I actually have a budget per listing. And so that will include featuring it on StreetEasy so that it shows up at the top of that search rather than in the middle, okay? Also, Facebook. Today I just launched a property on the Upper West Side. I had a guy do a video of the actual photos that we had professionally taken. He did the video, it was beautifully done. I just posted it up on Facebook. I paid $30 for an ad, and hopefully that'll reach thousands of people. That ad right there could sell that apartment. LinkedIn, we all have networks, right? You might know the person that's gonna buy that apartment. Well, I don't know, you know, but it just is. So if you know anybody, it's a one bedroom for $5.95. There you go, that's another form of advertising that we share. There's actually an example in that booklet of a case study of an apartment that I actually sold earlier this year where we broke a record in the building. And since then nobody's been able to break it again, I'm not obviously selling those. So when it comes to marketing, we also talk about the outreach internationally to other markets. Maybe your buyer's coming from Florida. We actually have connections with agencies in around the world, actually, in Miami, Fort Lauderdale, Canada, Dubai, London, Spain. We have access to your listing. We'll get in front of all of those people as well. And I will say, though, that the marketing strategy is unique to each and every home, okay? So what I put up on Facebook with one audience might be a totally different audience for a different apartment. And the last thing would be, once the buyers come through, once we get them in, what is the screening process like? Are we just showing it to anybody? No. We want to make sure that we know, as a broker, it's our job to know what your building allows. Do they allow pied-à-terre? Do they allow parents buying for children? How much financing do they allow? How much money do they want to see in reserves? What's the pet policy? That's the broker's job to know that stuff. And then it's our job to screen the buyers that are coming in. So helping to screen them with each offer that comes in, looking at their financial statement. Do they qualify? Maybe the bank says that they're qualified, but maybe they don't qualify for your board, right? And most boards are more strict. As a co-op owner and a board member and a screening committee member, I've seen lots of these board packages. I don't know what every board looks for, but I do know what a more conservative board will look for. So a lenient board is even better. So that's the broker's job, to screen them. And then only present those offers to you. And say that you have multiple offers. What do you do? It's great, right? Everybody thinks that it's great, but what if you get five offers and only two of them are actually qualified? Well, that's our job to also say, okay, maybe we're going to strategize and only reach out to those two and get them to give us their highest and best or ask for more information. Then we work on the board package with the broker. We make sure that that thing is typed, it's beautifully done, presented on time, and we make sure that the process moves through, right, so that we can get to the closing table as smoothly as possible. So those are about the four things that I think most sellers want to have concerns about, are thinking about, you know, what is this person that I'm hiring who's going to be in my home and showing my home on a regular basis going to do for me. If you have any other questions, I do have a lot of resources on my website. I have videos, I have seller's guides, buyer's guides. I also help sellers who are also trying to buy at the same time, which is a whole strategy in itself. So if you have any other questions, all of our contact information and our cards are on the back of this presentation as well as on the table. Are there any questions?
Yes. Yeah, one general question.
Yes.
How has the second, since we're on the Upper East Side, mm-hmm. how has the Second Avenue subway affected
Great question. Systems? Great question. So we actually had those stats. We have an in-house statistician who knows how to dissect all of this. And what we've been finding is that overall the market is still very tight, but we haven't seen a spike. And I think, as I just said, like because of the lag in the reporting, I don't think we'll really see those stats for probably until next year. You know, we've really only gotten through 3 quarters with the subway, so really these stats, knowing that they're from like January through April maybe, it's hard to tell. As an agent representing sellers in the area and buyers, I can tell you that buyers are coming from all corners of the city up here. Where they might never come, now they're coming. You know, so in fact, Debbie and I are working on a deal now, a 2-bedroom on 83rd Street, super unique apartment, like two bed, two bath duplex that Donna actually staged. And within, which I thought was gonna be like the hardest apartment to sell, within a week and a half or so, we had 3 offers. So, and the subway is right down the street. I had a five in that same building, I sold a 5-story, you know, 5-floor unit, which was slightly smaller. It was just a 1-bed. That was maybe 8 years ago, give or take. That took a couple months to sell. Of course, it's a 5th floor, but, you know, it sold super fast. It was priced well.
A walk-up?
It was a walk-up, 2nd and 3rd floor, but priced to sell. We compared it to all the other active comps, and this one, not quite there because there weren't really comps for it, but, you know, the people who bought it, the people that were coming in, they're coming in from downtown, they're trying to get more space, they're coming in from Long Island, from Westchester, like, this is an attractive area now. So I think that we are still seeing that the market is, you know, it's kind of settling and transitioning into what some might think is more of a buyer's market, but I do think that up here there is still, we're still holding our values up here. And you should go up. Any other questions? Yes?
What's the main age range that's buying up here right now?
Fair housing, all over. it's completely mixed. Mm. It's completely mixed. I think you could see from this room who lives in the area. I think most of us are Upper East Siders, right? So you could see, you know, it's a huge mix. You've got, I mean, the people that I just sold that apartment to were a young family with a baby.
Right.
You know, and then you've got couples, everybody. There's no average. In the whole city, there's no average. So with that, I'll pass it over to Debbie to talk about the legal side. I think each one gets more fun.
Yeah, right. I think we're the most fun. So hello again. I am Debbie, and I am a residential real estate attorney. So really my job, and I get involved in a typical transaction once you have placed your apartment on the market and you're starting to get ready to sell it. I tell a lot of clients, technically you don't need me until you have an accepted offer, but it doesn't hurt to start talking to counsel beforehand so you have somebody lined up, they're ready to go, they're available. One piece of advice I can give to any seller is you should definitely use somebody who's local, and you should use somebody who actually does real estate. So using your brother's, uncle's, dad's, mom, whatever it might be, family friend who's in
Westchester, I'm sure they'll do a great job, maybe, but they don't move things as fast as we do. They don't always do things the way that we do here. We know how quick the market needs to move, how quickly the transaction needs to move. So that's probably my number one piece of advice to any buyer or seller, honestly, is time can kill deals, as I'm sure Karen can tell you as well from her experience. And so it's really important to be represented by people who know the market well. So my first little piece of advice. But usually the first question I get from most clients is, well, what is this gonna cost me, right? Which I get. And in this beautiful pamphlet that you all have, there are two examples of closing costs or potential closing costs. I'm not gonna go line by line, you can kind of look through it and see, but I'll start with, there's a couple closing costs that pretty much are covered across the board, whether you are selling a co-op or selling a condo or selling a townhouse, brownstone, or even if you were out in Westchester for some reason or whatnot and selling a freestanding home. So the first one is the broker's commission, which you'll certainly negotiate with your broker, but usually on average that's about 5 to 6% depending on the deal. And the second one that you see, especially obviously here in New York City, is both New York City transfer tax and New York State transfer tax. New York City transfer tax is 1% if you're selling something that's $500,000 or under, and it is 1.425% if you are selling something that's over $500,000. And then New York State likes to dip their hand in as well, and they collect 0.4% of the sales price. So depending, it can either be 1.4% or 1.825%. And then the city also collects a small little filing fee on top of that for about $100. So right off the bat, just between potential brokers, transfer taxes, you're looking at somewhere on average between 7 to 8%. If you are selling in a co-op, most co-ops in New York City do have something called a flip tax or a transfer fee. I have seen them range from anywhere from $10 a share to 1% of the sales price to a percentage of a net profit, depending on what you are selling it for versus what you bought it for, and then you can subtract some things to it. So potentially if you add that into it, you're looking at anywhere between probably 8 to 10% give or take. And then obviously the other fees that potentially could be included, you have, you know, obviously legal fees. If it's a co-op, there's usually like a managing agent fee, transfer agent fee. There could also be fees, you know, regarding some co-op fees, maybe like move out fees. Some other co-ops charge small little fees like that. If also it's a co-op and you have a mortgage currently on the premises, you potentially could be paying the payoff bank attorney to show up as well. So that's another added fee. So the little things can certainly add up. And obviously, if you are looking to sell and you want to go over potential costs for your property, you could always give me a call and we can sort of walk through the numbers a little bit. But just on average, it's just sort of something to keep in mind, the joys of it. Also, if you are not a New York State resident, there potentially could be capital gains paid, and I can certainly leave that to Doug to discuss, but they may or may not be due at the time of closing, depending on if you are located in New York or not. But since you guys are sitting here, I'm guessing you are. So that's just a quick overview regarding closing costs. Like I said, we can always go into more detail on that. Does anybody have any questions? Good, I love it. A couple other points that I usually talk to most sellers about when they are starting to list their apartment or start to think about listing their apartment, certain things especially. First of all, it's always great to be open, upfront, and honest with both your lawyer and your broker. It can only help the process move a little bit faster and easier and smoother. But especially when you're listing it, is there anything, you know, because in the contract of sale, we usually include inclusions and exclusions. So there's usually boilerplate language that says chandeliers, light fixtures, AC units, if there were carpeting, for instance. But mirrors are all inclusive unless specifically excluded. And so if you have this light fixture that is an heirloom and you are dying to take it with you, tell your broker, tell your lawyer. Because if you don't put it in the contract, the buyer might assume that they're getting it.
if there's a mirror that you love from IKEA, but you really love it and you want to take it with you, you can, but you got to let somebody know. I can promise you that it will only hinder and slow a deal down if you don't tell us in advance. We prepare a contract of sale because we didn't know about it, and then the buyer signs it, and then you go to sign it, and you're like, oh, what about that, you know, chandelier I'm taking? You know, and now all of a sudden we have to stop, we have to go back to the other side, let them know that there's a chandelier that has to go, and the buyer was in love with the chandelier, and now it becomes a thing, and so it's just better and easier. I can't tell you how many times it happens. Doorknobs, for instance. You could love the doorknob and you want to take it with you. Be my guest. Just tell me you're going to do it. But yeah, it only helps to be upfront about those types of things. On that same level of being upfront and honest with your broker and your lawyer, the standard boilerplate contract in New York is an as-is purchase, but there are certain representations that get made in every contract. Most importantly, all appliances will be in working order, and usually there's representation that plumbing, heating, electrical systems are also in working order. It's okay if something doesn't work, but tell us it doesn't work. Or just tell me the dishwasher actually doesn't work and I'm not intending to fix it. Great. When your broker is selling the property, we can mention it. By the way, the dishwasher's not working. All excluded in the contract. All appliances will be in working order except for the dishwasher. You will take it as is. It happens all the time, it's not a big deal, but the worst thing that's gonna happen is that you don't tell anybody about it, the buyer goes to do their final walkthrough, test the dishwasher doesn't work. You say, but it never worked. Okay, but you didn't say that. So it only helps to provide as much information as you can to your attorney, to your broker, to sort of help the process move smoothly. So that's something else I'd just like to point out. And if you have a specific question about something maybe in your unit, obviously you can certainly let me know. Other probably biggest thing that I talk to my clients about is the closing date. Most contracts of sale, they will list a closing date as an on or about date. What does that mean? Let's say on or about December 15th. If come December 15th, the parties are not ready and able to close, that's okay. The on or about language gives either party, buyer and seller, the right to reasonably adjourn the closing if necessary. And we usually say that reasonable standard is about 30 days. So if it's a co-op and the buyer's not approved by the board yet, we can't force them to the table. Or on the other hand, you are going to celebrate the holidays in Aspen with your family and you're like, sorry, I'm away for Christmas and I don't want to move until January 5th and I'll happily close on the 7th. You have that same right that buyer does. So it's something to keep in mind, especially if you are trying to time things. Karen mentioned it before, but we work with a lot of people who are trying to buy and sell at the same time. So it's really important to talk to your attorney about that, how best to discuss the date. This is also would be a time where if potentially if you are doing a buy and sell situation, you might want to ask the buyer in advance if they'd be willing to maybe do a post possession, which would give you the right to sell your property, but then remain in your property for a certain period of time after closing, so that maybe you can use the funds from your sale to buy something else. And that's obviously more details we could go into at another time, but it's definitely something to think about. If timing is really important to you, if you know you're starting a job out of state, if you're moving out of the country and you're not able to attend the closing, we could also work with you and do something called a power of attorney, which gives us a limited power to do signing on your behalf, so you don't have to be there if you can't physically make it. It just happens all the time, or a lot of my clients just don't want to come. So we're happy to do that too. So that's also something that sort of, again, you can discuss that with your attorney. It's easily done. Most managing agents have no issue with it, so that's also good to do. And then probably the other thing I just wanted to mention to any sellers who happen to be, that have rental properties, you're looking to sell a property that has a tenant in place, don't let the tenant prohibit you from possibly being able to market that property. You can sell property with a tenant in place. You just have to make that clear, show your broker, show any prospective purchasers, the lease, how long the tenant will be there for, you know, any other details regarding that, especially if you are looking to buy investment properties. And also if you are selling an investment property, potentially discussing with both your attorney and your accountant, which I'll certainly let Doug handle, it would be 1031 exchanges, which he can talk about the joys of that. Surely he gets up here. But it's definitely something to discuss, especially if you know that you're doing an investment property and you're looking to buy another potential investment property. It's definitely a conversation I recommend having. And that's probably a very general, but hopefully semi-specific overview of things to think about. Any questions? Comments? Concerns? Was that fun? You guys are so good. Yay! Okay, well, think about them. Let me know. And Doug.
No, I'm going to do the most fun part. Does anybody want to take a quick 30-second break before I start?
I can leave your food off the table.
So, all right. Hi, everybody. So we're going to talk about taxes and how it affects the sale of your residence, and then some of the other topics. Deb touched on some of them, and we'll try to get into some of those as well. So, no, that one's me.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Oh, never mind.
It's okay. So, first off, if you sell your principal residence, you can exclude some of the gain. However, before we can talk about excluding the gain, we've got to know what the gain is. And everybody's got to figure out the cost basis of their residence. When they sell, they're going to report the sale, perhaps on your tax return. You might get a form, a 1099-S, that's going to tell you what the gross proceeds are on your sale, but we also need to know what you paid for the apartment, and we also need to know if you made any improvements to that apartment. And improvements can also mean assessments that the co-op or the condo charged you during the years. So it's important as you're planning this process to start to think about what you paid, what you renovated. You did a bathroom, renovated, built another room, you put a wall up, anything that was legal, you did your kitchen, maybe did the bathroom, a second bathroom if you have one, renovated that, you want to start to gather those costs. The one thing that I find from my seat is nobody ever remembers what the assessments were. They know they paid their common charges every month, but they don't know if there was a special charge somewhere. So in advance, try to see if you can gather some of that historical information. If you can't, you do the best you can. But it's certainly a good resource for that historical information, maybe your management company, or maybe some longtime board members in the building, they may remember. But you'll do the best you can. Then, when you actually have your sales price and you have your cost basis, including all of those improvements and all those assessments, you have a gain. However, from that gain, all those closing costs that Debbie talked about, you can reduce the gain by all of those closing costs. The broker's commission, the attorney's fees, the transfer tax, the flip tax, the decluttering that Donna's going to talk about soon, that comes under a category called fixing up expenses, which could be, hey, I painted these couple of rooms. That's not an improvement. You painted it. Those were in anticipation of sale. There's a timeline. If you painted 5 years ago, that's not a fixing up expense in anticipation of sale. The code says 3 months. I would say if you've done it recently in anticipation of sale, you'd probably be okay, even though we're recording this. I will also say that in 35 plus years of doing taxes for individuals, I've not once had the IRS ask a client to prove the cost basis. That doesn't mean they won't, and that doesn't mean they can't. I've just not seen it in 35 years of doing taxes for individuals. So I just share that with you for informational purposes as you figure out how you're going to arrive at your cost basis, and I'm going to help you do that. That's one of the things. So we've now figured out our sales price, we've figured out our cost basis, we've got all our closing costs, we've got our fixing up expenses. Now, do we have a gain? Yes, because Karen got you a set a price that was record breaking. You now have a gain. So if you are single and you sell your apartment and your gain is less than $250,000, no tax for federal tax purposes, state tax purposes, or city income tax, city tax purposes. And that is, well, those are just income taxes. Those are not the transfer taxes or any other taxes that Debbie was talking about. Those are based on just the sales price. But for income tax purposes, if you're single, you sell, and your gain is less than $250,000, there's no tax that's owed this year. If you're married, it's a $500,000 exclusion of that gain. One very important fact. Must have been your principal residence for 2 out of the last 5 years. If you rented it for the last 5 years, no exclusion. If you rented it for some portion, we've got to just look at the timeline. So it must be your principal residence for 2 out of the last 5 years. So you could actually sell it after you move out, as long as by the time you sell it, it's within that time frame of 2 of the last 5 years, and then you can exclude the gain. But don't try to figure that out after the fact. Make sure you speak to me or your accountant to make sure you've got that timeline in place, because if you don't exclude, if you lose that $250,000 or $500,000 exclusion, that can be, as we know, pretty costly. Minimum of 15% federal capital gain rate, and between state and city, minimum of about 11 to 12%. So you're talking 27% tax. There can be add-ons to that. So you want to be very mindful of taking advantage of the exclusions. We talked about the closing costs. We talked about it being your principal residence, 2 out of 5 years on your exclusion. What we see a lot,
I was confused about how you can use the closing costs. Which closing costs are you talking about? The closing costs when you're selling the apartment, or the closing costs you pay when you initially bought?
That's a great question. So the closing costs that you paid when you bought the unit, those increase your cost basis. So Karen was talking about an apartment, $595,000. You buy that apartment, but there are going to be closing costs on the purchase side, attorney's fees, mortgage costs. Those are all going to add to your cost basis on your purchase price. Take that into account when you figure out your overall cost basis for tax purposes. And then upon your sale, in 5 years, you're going to sell that apartment for $900,000. Good? With Karen's good marketing. But you're going to subtract from that $900,000 the closing costs that you've incurred on the sale. So the short answer is you get both. You get the closing costs that you paid when you purchased, and you get to subtract the closing costs that you incur on the sale. And those all come into play when you figure out your taxable gain on the sale of your unit. A couple of other things.
That's good.
A lot of times we see people who they want to sell their unit, they're going to buy something else, but they say, I don't want to sell yet. I want to rent out my unit. I want to find a tenant and let them live there. So we talked about the 2 out of 5 year rule. You've got to be mindful of that. However, if you're renting out that unit, number one, you're going to have rental income as you go during the rental term. There are going to be expenses that you can take against that rental income. I don't want to make this about that net income from the rental. However, there's something else you can take, and it's called depreciation. IRS code allows for depreciation. It lets you write off the cost. And we now, everybody knows what the cost is, and you can write that cost off over a 30-year time frame. So it's maybe not very much in some years, but it's basically a 30-year time frame, 27.5 years. But that depreciation that you take, that is not excludable when you sell your unit. So I'm getting a little deep here, but we think you could exclude your gain of $250,000 or $500,000. But if you've rented it out for a couple of years and you've had $10,000 or $20,000 of depreciation during that time frame, you're gonna recapture that depreciation and you're gonna pay tax on that. You're gonna pay income tax when you sell your unit. Now Deb, speaking about rental units, mentioned the fact of 1031 exchanges. 1031 is a term, but it's a code section in the IRS code that says if you sell one unit, one home, and buy a rental property, and you buy another rental property, you can exclude temporarily, it's really a deferral of the gain from the sale of the first unit. Again, not for the scope of this meeting, but just something to be aware of. If you have a rental property and you want to get another rental property, you may be able to defer the gain, not pay tax on it today, maybe later pay the tax on it. I just had an interesting situation where a client had a piece of property that they acquired via 1031 exchange. They lived there, the requisite, did not live there, continued to use it as an investment property for many, many years. Now they're going to move into it. And they're never going to leave. The only way they're going to leave that new residence is when they pass away. They're never going to pay tax on that property. All right? So 1031 exchanges, very interesting section of the law. Terrific opportunities, lots of rules about when and how you do that 1031 exchange. Takeaway is, if you have a rental property now and you're going to sell it at some point, but you want to get another rental property in a completely different location, it may qualify as a 1031 exchange. Think about it in advance so you can meet those timelines and talk about what the rules and regulations are. The last piece I want to touch on just a little bit is, because I see it a lot, somebody sells their residence in New York and they want to move to Florida. But they sell the residence and then they continue to rent a place in New York, so they remain a New York resident, or they've sold and they have moved to Florida. They sell, they move to Florida, but they have a taxable gain on the sale of that apartment. They don't exceed the exclusion amounts. They pay tax on the amounts in excess of the exclusion. Number one, you still pay tax in New York, even though you've moved to Florida, because the real property is located in New York. As Deb said, New York State, New York City, they're going to withhold tax from those sales proceeds, and they're going to take that tax money on day one when you have your closing. You still file a New York State return, you may get a refund for some of those New York State taxes when you file your return, but New York State's not going to wait around for you to come back later to file that return and pay the tax on New York State. Similarly, if you continue to own a property in New York, you pass away, but you live someplace else, that property may be subject to New York State estate tax. Again, not the scope of this discussion, but all things to be thinking about. In terms of residency, it's very important if it's something that you're considering. Also think about your days in New York, your days not in New York. When do you move? And if you already have a place in Florida and you go to Florida, what changed to cause you to move? And the story I heard is nobody ever moves on January 1st, because what New York State says, oh, so New Year's Eve, where'd you spend New Year's Eve? Well, I watched the ball drop in Times Square. And you moved then on January 1st? How did you get a mover between midnight and January 1st? So I heard it. I think it's a great analogy. So and New York's very aggressive about wanting us to all continue to be residents of New York, because they want our tax money. The other thing that they know, that once you move out of New York State, you don't vote anymore. So you have to pay your taxes, but you can't vote them out of office. With that, questions?
A long time ago, I used to hear that if you were 55 or over, mm-hmm. and you sold your co-op or a home, mm-hmm. you didn't pay any tax on that. If you bought another property with a than 2 years. Does that still exist?
So there were two rules that existed for many, many years. One of them was if you were 55 or over and sold your home, you had qualified for something called a one-time exclusion. Right? Gone. That's gone. The other rule said if you sell your residence and you buy a new principal residence and you pay more for the new principal residence, you could roll over the gain from the first home. So you had a property, you paid $200,000 for it, you sold it for $600,000, you had a $400,000 gain. If you bought a place for $601,000, that $400,000 gain got deferred. They did away with that all as well. All you have is the $250,000 or $500,000 exclusion. Everything else is taxed.
He's very
doesn't like that. Right.
Yeah.
Other questions? How about now? Contact information's in there. I'll be here. Ask questions later.
Except for the big K. Okay. Thank you, guys. I introduced myself before. Donna Clemick. My company is Declutter 123, and I am a decluttering coach, and I stage apartments for sale. And usually what Karen does is say, hey, meet my client who wants to sell. They need a little bit of organization. They need a little bit of staging. So I end up working directly for you guys who are trying to sell. Okay? There are basically two kinds of staging. Staging an empty apartment and staging an owner-occupied apartment. 90% of my work is owner-occupied. Is anybody selling an empty apartment? No. You're all living in it, right? Okay. Just to go through it very quickly, when I stage an empty apartment, it goes very quickly. We make sure things are clean and painted. There's no repairs that need to be done. I rent furniture, I rent art, I rent rugs, and I make purchases of towels for the bathroom, linens for the bed, tchotchkes. Make it look nice. It happens very quickly, and it's done. When I stage an apartment, which I said is really 99% of my work that you guys are still living in, it's a completely different situation. We also have to, we take care of cleaning, we make sure if the walls need painting, they're painted. If you have a red wall, I'll tell you to paint the red wall white, okay? We make sure all of the repairs are done. We don't want people to go into your bathroom and see a brown spot in your ceiling. We don't want them to hear the toilet running. Because a move-in ready apartment gets you more money. It really does. So the little amount of money that I ask you to spend to fix things makes a big, big difference. And also, they come into the bank, into your apartment, they're like, this has not been cared for. So what else am I not seeing? You know, they want to see an apartment that has been loved and cared for, and they feel more comfortable buying it. They're not hiding anything from them, okay? So the next stage after all this is probably the thing that is the most time-consuming. It's the decluttering. Now, I've been a decluttering coach for almost 20 years, you know. Everybody's got too much stuff. Everybody has got too much stuff. The people who are coming in to look at your apartment, they have too much stuff, and which is why we have to empty your closets out. This is always a big deal with people. They come into your house to see your apartment. They open the door, and it literally takes them about 3 seconds for them to have a very strong reaction to your apartment. They may not be cognizant of it, but they have a reaction to your apartment. They either like it or they don't. And you can change a person's mind, you know, when they walk into the other room, they go, oh, wow, this is fabulous. But it's hard. it's hard to change your first impression. So your first impression of the apartment is really very, very important. Clutter. When there's clutter in an apartment, person comes in to look at your place and they can't see your apartment. Your eyes immediately go to clutter. They go to the stack of papers on the desk, the pile of shoes over there. If there's any dirt or grime or congestion, their eyes go right to the clutter. They do not even see your apartment. I once walked into a fabulous master bedroom, $15 million apartment, and I was like, okay, this is a gorgeous apartment, but there's stacks of shoes over there, there's boxes over here, there's all this. I'm looking at all the clutter. I was in the room for 5 minutes before I realized there was a Chagall hanging over the bed. Didn't even see it. And finally I walked to the window and I go, oh, we overlook Central Park. Didn't notice it, because the only thing I was concentrating on was the stuff lining the walls of this bedroom. And it was a beautiful apartment, but it really doesn't matter how beautiful your apartment is. If there's clutter, the Zoom type, if there's clutter, they're not going to see it, okay? So we go through your closets. A closet, you know, if you open a really big closet and something falls on your head, or even if something doesn't fall on your head, if you open a closet, a 6-foot closet, and it's stuffed, you have this feeling that there's no room in this place for my stuff. Remember, they got too much stuff too, right? They want more storage than they have, no matter how much storage they have. So closets have to be literally half empty. They have to be neat, they have to be organized. If there's a bookcase on the wall, the bookcase has to be half empty. It gives you a feeling that there's room in this place for you. Basically what we're doing is we are creating a blank canvas for them to walk in and to be able to envision themselves living in the apartment. That's what staging does. It's not decorating. I'm not making your place look pretty. I'm making your place appeal to the broadest range of people that we can, because it's a numbers game. We're neutralizing it. We're literally creating a blank canvas, because their life is going to come into your apartment. I know you love your grandchildren. I know you love your sister's kids, but all those pictures of them lining the wall, I'm going to tell you to take them down, because people come in, they feel like they're visiting you. We don't want them to feel like they're visiting somebody. We want them to walk in to say, I can imagine myself very easily living here. And look at all this space. So I'm going to ask you to move a lot of your furniture, okay? I never tell anybody that they have to throw anything out, but I'll be totally honest with you and tell you, you have too much furniture here. You know, we could put it in your grandma's basement. We can rent a storage unit, but we need to see the apartment. People are coming in, they're buying the ceiling, the walls, the floor, they're buying the sunlight, they're buying the flow, they're buying the square footage, and they're buying the feeling that they get when they come into your home. We want them to buy into the feeling that they have when they come into your home. So, you know, buyers come in and everybody has I must have these things when they're looking for an apartment. I must have a washer dryer in the apartment. I must have lots of storage. They always want lots of storage, going back to the closet. I must have lots of natural light. You know, and then there's like, I want to live between 63rd and 65th Street. They have all these things that they want, and that's the logical side of them, because they are logical needs, but logical is not the only thing happening in a buyer's mind. There's also the emotional side to it. So my job as a stager is to take care of the logical things, but it's also to take care of the emotional side. We need for them to connect, to be able to connect to your apartment. So no apartment is perfect. So what we do is we accentuate the wonderful things about your apartment and we diminish the bad things about it. And that has to do with furniture placement, it has to do with color, it has to do with styling, it has to do with flow. These are all the things a good stager does. And we have to depersonalize, as I said, the photos, the erotic art. You would be surprised what is in people's apartment. You know, I've gone into some place and go, oh, that's beautiful. You know, but I think we should take it down. But it's a famous artist. I go, I'm sure it is, but it has to come down. And it's always you're walking on thin ice because you don't want to insult anybody's taste. But basically, what you said before, the buyer doesn't care about your taste. It's not about your taste. It's not about your artwork. It's not about the beautiful crystal that you have everywhere. They don't care about you and your taste. It has to be broad appeal. That's what we're going for, because that's the only way you're going to sell your apartment. Okay? And chances are the buyers are going to be younger. And they have a totally different aesthetic. They are not interested in antiques. They're not interested in fancy this, fancy that. It's sleek, it's streamlined, it's simple, and they want space, and they want storage. So you're appealing to somebody that is not like you. So, and this person will be shopping online. As you guys said, they're shopping online. If they don't like photo, they're not coming to your house. And they're all walking down Fifth Avenue going like this, looking at a 2x2 inch photo of your living room. And if it doesn't pop at them, they're going, next. So that's why Karen has a fabulous photographer, because that's the first line of your sale, is your online photo. So a staged apartment, a decluttered staged apartment, is a photo that pops. Look online at comparable apartments, your area, your price, your size, and you just tell me which of the apartments you want to go to. It's the decluttered, simple, streamlined apartment, okay? And you gotta, let's see, what's the best way of saying this? Your friend is not the person to have do this for you. Your mother, your friend, your best friend. You need somebody that has no physical, no emotional, no history, no connection to you. Somebody who is absolutely objective. The money. If you spend $1,000 staging your apartment, you're gonna get $30,000 back. That's New York Times, that's Zillow, that's New York Real Estate Staging Association. So every dollar you spend, you get 30 back, okay? So these are all the reasons to stage. You get a lot more money. It sells quicker. It goes in 1/3 the time. Staged decluttered apartments sell in 1/3 the time. And you know that every day your apartment stays on the market, it goes down and down and down in price. It's very hard to bring that back up. And it's going to basically help your competition if you don't stage, because the apartment that they just came from is staged and decluttered, and the next three apartments that they go to after they look at yours are staged and decluttered. Okay. It's a thought process that will get you a lot of money. Okay. Any questions? I've talked too long. I know I have. Yes.
The figures that you talked about, 1,000, 30,000.
Yes.
Decluttering and staging, so on and so forth. Does that apply only to New York, or is that a general consensus throughout?
Well, New York is a very tough market. If you go to Wisconsin, they'll go, staging? What's staging?
Really? And then you look at the listings in Wisconsin and you see like a pile of guns in the corner and the dog is on the couch.
How about South Florida?
South Florida, no, that's a very hip market. They're staging in South Florida. You know? But anybody that wants to sell for more money and faster, you have to stage it.
What about you?
Virtual staging.
Virtual staging? Mm-hmm. What do you think of virtual staging?
Well, I know that, from my perspective, a buyer sees the virtual staging. First of all, I can always tell when I'm looking at photos. I'm like, that.
Do you guys know what virtual staging
no.
is?
Oh, no.
Explain what virtual staging is.
Okay. So it's digitally done. It's on a computer.
Yeah.
Where they take an empty room and they plop in a couch and a table and a lamp and everything artificial. And you can usually tell from the photos, and these days most brokerage firms require you to have, you know, virtually staged on the photo, like that disclosure. But I find that most buyers walk in, they see it online, or they get so excited, they see it's beautifully done, because a stager would stage it the same way. But then they walk in and they go, wait, what? Like,
it's
what
a
happened
breakdown. Here? I'm not a big fan of it. It looks like a cartoon to me online.
There's nothing
as
super accurate about it. Like,
yeah.
The size
and
of
then,
the furniture is off. Like, everything's a little.
And then again, you have them walk through the door, and the first emotion they feel is disappointment when they enter your apartment. So that's how I feel about virtual staging. So, anybody have a question?
Do the 360 viewers make any difference?
The virtual reality?
Yeah, like that kind
okay,
of, do you
yeah.
notice any difference when people utilize that, or?
I prefer a nice, good photographer with a wide angle lens.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, because they're going to find that angle that sells your living room. And that's going to be it, and people are going to see the reality of your living room. They're going to come because it's a good shot. That's why you have to have a good photographer. And most rooms don't look good 360.
Most
rooms have maybe two good angles.
Yeah.
I think virtual reality, which is huge elsewhere, but here, I mean, reality is a lot of us face a wall. A lot of us have a kitchen the size of this table. Do we really want to show that? Like, what it really is? Like, no, we need to get them in. We need to get them to come and see.
Yeah,
and
that's the only reason for photographs. Not to enlighten them, it's to bring them in. Because you're not going to sell it to somebody unless they walk through the door.
Yeah.
You
gotta get people.
You know? So, anyway. Any more questions?
It's a scary rate. It pays off, I will tell you.
It really pays off. You know, 9 out of 10 of my apartments that I've staged to declutter sell the first open house.
It's also a pricing strategy.
It is a nice strategy. We're actually a very good team.
Yes. but it looks nice. You know,
yeah,
and
that
apartment
that you had quoted before was a very odd apartment.
Oh, it was super
so
strange.
Odd.
I mean,
she
railroad apartment.
She
and
walked me and she goes, I don't know what to do with this. And I'm like, I don't either. But then we figured it out. Because it has to be figured out.
Yeah.
And we did. We figured it out. We staged it for very little money.
Oh, it was ridiculous.
Very little money because it wasn't a high-end staging. I have a 7,000 square foot brownstone on in Brooklyn Heights that I'm working on. That requires high-end staging. This didn't.
The seller decided that it made sense to purchase the furniture instead of renting the furniture.
Mm-hmm.
And we brought in a few pieces like rugs and some artwork from a previous project. And
yeah, we did it
very
quickly.
Plug and play, it fit. The park, like I said, it's a railroad apartment. So lots of little random rooms, and we had to make it make sense. A buyer is expecting you to figure it out for them.
Right.
Right.
They can't be expected to unsee anything. They can't be expected to be able to imagine those two sofas and the three chairs gone, so that their sofa can fit there. You can't expect them to do that.
It's not personal,
but they're going to another apartment where there is room for their sofa. So.
All right. So with that, are there any other questions?
For any of us?
Any of us? No? Great. Well, we thank you again for coming.
Yes.
And the point of tonight was to be a resource.
Oh.
Here, yeah. So the point of tonight was to be a resource to you. So take all of our information, contact us as you want. Again, no obligations by coming tonight. We just want you to make an informed decision. Whatever you decide to do, we're here to help. Okay?
Absolutely.
And we'd love to see you back here.
On with that. If you'd like to come, it's okay.
And